both of which would have essentially required her to give up her career aspirations. This focus on work and creativity very much ran against the grain of the typical lifestyle expected of women at the time. In her program note, Larsen writes, quote, "I have combined the mezzo-soprano as the embodied character of Cassatt, with the trombone as Cassatt's spirit to create a fuller understanding of the artist," end quote. A relationship which we will see play out over the duration of the composition, with the piano and percussion providing a role of equal importance to that of the soloist in the narrative of the piece. In the first movement, To Be a Painter, we hear Cassatt express her desire to become a painter and move to Europe, very much to the dismay of her father. This proclamation followed several years of study at the Pennsylvania Academy of the Fine Arts from 1860 through 1862. Larsen built most of her libretto directly from Cassatt's own pen, through letters she wrote that still survive today. Relying on these primary sources gives us direct insight into much of what Cassatt was thinking and feeling as her career developed. Upon the first entrance of the piano, Larsen introduces a theme that will return throughout the composition. What I refer to as Mary's theme sounds like this. Coming from this simplistic beginning, this motivic idea will take on numerous forms throughout the piece, capturing the various emotional states that Cassatt is in as her career and life unfold. The second movement captures Cassatt as she travels to Europe for the first time. Specifically, she's heading to Paris, France. Larsen saturates this movement with a unique treatment of this familiar music. That music comes from French composer Jacques Offenbach's Orpheus in the Underworld, and today is synonymous with, as you might have guessed, the can-can. The can-can is a dance that began appearing in France around 1830, but became much more widespread during the second half of the 19th century. While there is much music composed that one could dance the can-can to, this Offenbach example is perhaps the strongest modern-day reference to the dance. At the time, the term can-can in French slang meant malicious gossip or scandal. The dance, in which women kick their legs high into the air, was seen as being very promiscuous or even raunchy, and was a way for women to rebel against the Victorian values of the time. By quoting and altering this familiar tune, Larsen is commenting on how Mary Cassatt was tossing aside the traditional roles of her time and is choosing to blaze her own path. Near the end of this movement, Mary's theme returns, but this time in a seemingly disillusioned state. After hearing the news of being rejected from the Paris Salon, Cassatt expresses how little she has worked and seems to question her future as an artist and where exactly in the world she is meant to be.
In 1868, I decided to become a painter.
place from 1870 to 1871. The details leading up to the war are not particularly important in the context of this piece, but it is important to know that the war did not end well for the French. During this time period, when seemingly all creative activity in France stopped, Cassatt chose to return home to America for her safety. Larsen makes very overt quotations of this piece in this movement. Of the Hungarian March from the Damnation of Faust by yet another French composer, Hector Berlioz. Initially, the reference to Hungary seems rather out of place in a movement depicting a war that had no involvement from the Hungarians. However, there is a deep and nuanced historical connection being made here. Beginning in the Middle Ages, there are Hungarian sources that claim ancestral descent from the Huns. Although this has not been proven to be scientifically or genealogically true, belief in this portion of Hungary's ethnic identity still persists today on some level. Fast forward to 1900, three decades after the Franco-Prussian War, Kaiser Wilhelm II of Germany made a statement in relation to the German military involvement in the Boxer Rebellion in China, in which he ordered his troops to act ruthlessly towards the rebels. Quote, "Mercy will not be shown, prisoners will not be taken. Just as 1,000 years ago, the Huns under Attila won a reputation of might that lives on in legends, so may the name of Germany in China, such that no Chinese will ever again dare to look askance at a German." Later in the 20th century, particularly during World Wars I and II, this comparison between the ruthless Huns and the ruthless Germans, carrying with it a strong negative connotation, was exploited in both British and American war propaganda. The final piece of the puzzle is understanding what Germany has to do with the whole situation of the Franco-Prussian War. Prussia, of course, is a country that no longer exists today, but the land which used to make up Prussia is now largely modern-day Germany. Thus, we can reverse engineer the musical reference here from the land that was Prussia, now modern-day Germany, comparison between the ruthless Germans and the Huns, and the Hungarians claiming ancestral descent from the Huns, finally connecting back to the Berlioz example. By quoting Berlioz's Hungarian March here, Larsen is making a sophisticated reference that bridges over 1,000 years of history, showing how the Prussian military ravaged the French during this war. Now in movements 4 and 5, it's where we perhaps see the relationship between Cassatt's outward thoughts, sung by the mezzo, and her more inward feelings, played by the trombone, are the most played out. The fourth movement, Europe Again, occurs at the conclusion of the Franco-Prussian War in 1871. Cassatt made her return not initially to France, but to Italy for a brief period of time. Beginning with a furious and angular trombone solo, this music is representative of Cassatt's inward frustrations with having to put her career aspirations on hold during the war. The mezzo-soprano and the trombone exchange several phrases, with Cassatt expressing her strong desire to get back to work. As her statements continue, the angularity of the trombone line subsides, giving way to more calm and lyrical music, coinciding with the arrival of our first projection, an early artwork of Cassatt's dating from 1872. Near the conclusion of the movement, the mezzo and trombone come together for a soaring melodic statement as Cassatt expresses her pleasure with her now resumed work, stating, "Beautiful, lovely." The fusion of Cassatt's inward and outward thoughts here would seem to indicate a feeling of peace and satisfaction with her return to Europe and the work she so loves.
Thank you.
This compositional approach highlights Cassatt's disdain for the ideas and social status of those who are tasked with judging her artwork for acceptance or rejection of the Paris Salon. To Cassatt, the opinions of these men, one of whom she keenly points out isn't even an artist, is just a bunch of hot air. As the movement continues to unfold, we see several of Cassatt's earlier paintings projected on the screen, and Mary's theme is recalled. Shortly after her artwork, At the Opera, is projected, there is a stark musical contrast drawn by Larsen. The painting features Mary's sister, Lydia, viewing an opera from a box, while in the background, a man is focused on her, rather than paying attention to the drama unfolding on stage in front of him. This particular painting was crafted in Paris, around the same time period during which Bizet's famed opera Carmen had its premiere, thus arriving the second musical reference of the movement. While we can't say for certain whether Cassatt heard this opera during her time in Paris, it certainly is not out of the question. Larsen keenly recalls features of the Habanera from Carmen. Slightly altered here and played at a slower tempo, Larsen contrasts between duple and triple groupings of melodic notes, often with suave half-step relationships constituting much of the pitch information, with a touch of added flair from the castanets. As the excitement of this movement comes to an end, Larsen segues directly into movement 6, Degas, after a final scalar ascent in the trombone and a dramatic building of tension with the addition of a snare drum roll. Movement 6 begins by recalling the same angular and aggressive music that was played by the trombone at the onset of Movement 4, but quickly moves into new material. Fellow painter Edgar Degas was a good friend of Mary Cassatt, but this movement seems to chronicle the beginnings of their friendship as being rather tumultuous. The initial statement by the mezzo-soprano, Degas said to me, introduces a key theme, the Degas motif, that permeates this movement. The motif is quickly reiterated by the piano, cementing its importance as a key musical gesture in this movement and in movement 7. And now in its more common form, with multiple iterations of the motif stacked together. This motif takes on two forms throughout, most commonly as a five-note collection, but occasionally shortened to just four notes, and is always heard with the same ascending motion. This movement also features a return and reinvention of the can-can music from Movement 2. The text that Larsen chose for this movement highlights Degas' hesitancy with accepting Cassatt as a serious artist. Despite Paris being a somewhat progressive place at this time, you can hear aspects of an exclusionary attitude towards women working in the arts. However, Degas is clearly impressed, at one point muttering to himself, "What drawing? What style?" Keeping his high praise to himself and outwardly suggesting that Cassatt modeled the back in her painting titled Woman Bathing. Cassatt is clearly frustrated with the more renowned Degas refusing to outwardly accept her artistic skills, and the movement concludes with the most aggressive music of the whole piece, making use of the extreme low register of the trombone, paired with the dense restatement of the Degas motif in the piano, and finally building to a climax with the addition of another snare drum roll. The conclusion of the composition, Movement 7, Maturity, is saturated with the presence of Mary's theme, this musical gesture we have heard repeatedly throughout the duration of the work, and one that has continued to take on many different forms. Here in the final movement, Larsen treats it to many reinventions, expanding and augmenting the theme, altering its orchestration, and crafting a countermelody that sounds during the final restatement, coinciding with the projection of Cassatt's painting, Mother Nursing Her Baby. Earlier in the movement, Larsen also treats the Degas motif to its own reinvention, this time giving the pitch material a more tender and reflective approach played by the trombone, perhaps signifying that Cassatt has finally earned the respect of Degas. This recall of the Degas motif coincides with the projection of the banjo lesson, one of Cassatt's prints. Earlier still in the movement, this motif is heard closer to its original form, just as Cassatt is reckoning with her status as a painter of children and women, as is highlighted in the numerous projections throughout, despite Cassatt herself never bearing children or marrying. In fact, the final movement utilizes seven of Cassatt's artworks, nearly half of those projected in total during this piece, each of which celebrates mothers and children, emblematic of Cassatt finding her true artistic voice and true artistic maturity. Now, before we play these final three movements, I just want to thank you all again for joining us today.
Thank you.